Okay, so just reviewing methods that give you mixture of aldehydes and ketones. From alcohols, simple oxidation. So simple oxidation matlab using your direct oxidizing agents. So this is a laboratory preparation because you need to have control over these oxidizing agents. Again, you don't want to take this oxidation too far. So it needs to be dilute and cold and in alkaline condition. If you use concentrated, if you heat it slightly, or if you use it in acidic conditions, it's going to be a stronger oxidizing agents, and this is going to, you know, it's going to take it too far. You're going to get acids. So in order to control it, take slightly weaker oxidizing agents. So primary alcohols give you aldehydes, secondary alcohols give you ketones. Industrial preparation of aldehydes and ketones are you take alcohol vapors. Because you want vapors, you use volatile alcohols and you remove the hydrogen from them. So that's dehydrogenation, can be done using copper or silver metal tubes. Then from hydrocarbons, you have two ways of getting it. If you're using alkenes, ozonolysis, say you get aldehydes and ketones, you can control which one you get based on what are attached to the carbon atoms in the double bond. And fourth way is alkynes. Now this is a lot more stricter. You get only one type of aldehyde, which is acetaldehyde or ethanol from ethyne. And any other alkyne that you use, you're going to get only the ketones. Okay. Then, now coming to specific, like preparation of specifically aldehydes alone. So these methods, you will not get ketones at all because based on the reagent that you take, or the raw material, like the reactant that you take, is going to give you only aldehydes. So aldehyde specifically. All right. So first is from acyl chloride. What's the structure of acyl chlorides? We have come across this pehle also, like in while we're looking at other preparation of amines or properties of amines. Jasleen, close, like you don't need benzene there. So acyl chloride ka structure is, Aryan, you've given structure of ethyl chloride. No, this is acyl chloride, also called acid chloride. If that gives you guys a clue. Very nice. No, yeah, so R, C double bond O, Cl. Not COCl2, Ritwik. So this particular functional group is called an acyl chloride, okay? So in order to convert acyl chloride to aldehyde, what do you need to do? So this is your initial raw material. Finally, you want an aldehyde here. So what change is happening?
Ma'am, the chlorine is getting replaced.
With hydrogen, okay. So what is the best source of hydrogen?
Acid, HCl.
Proton, yeah. But again, you're introducing ions and all, right? The most straightforward thing is take hydrogen directly from H2 gas catalyzed by palladium on barium sulfate. So, yeah, so if it's simple addition of hydrogen, yes, with palladium or nickel, powdered palladium or nickel metal. In this case, it's slightly different because you're not breaking a double bond, you're not adding H2 gas to an existing molecule. So you take it on palladium on barium sulfate. Okay. So this is a named reaction. This is called Rosenmund reaction, reduction. So acyl chloride, you want to get aldehyde because you replace the chlorine with hydrogen, use hydrogen gas. Again, gaseous reactants, so catalyzed by palladium on barium sulfate. Okay, reduction is taking place because you're adding a hydrogen here. So it's called Rosenmund reduction. Next, another set of like named reactions, like kind of important reactions. So you can get aldehydes and ketones from nitriles and esters. So you use the same reagents in this case also, which is why they're grouped together. Okay. So nitriles are C triple bond N. And esters are C double bond O and then R dash, right? So nitriles ke liye, there are two ways to do it, but something that ties both of them together with nitriles and esters both is using this reagent called dibal H. All right. First, I'll discuss one thing that's like specific to nitriles. So if you've got R C triple bond N, this on treating with stannous chloride and HCl gives you like first, the C triple bond N gets reduced. So the triple bond gets converted to a double bond. You get R CH double bond NH. So this is a kind of compound that's called an imine. Amine is when you have all single bonds. Now when you have double bond, that gets, you just like A gets converted to E. So these are called imines. When you imines on hydrolysis gets oxidized to aldehydes. So this particular reaction is called Stefan reaction. So Stefan reaction, stannous chloride. So you can remember it, Stefan SnCl2. So SnCl2 can be used only with nitriles. Now, another reagent that can be used in this reduction is called dibal H. Full form of this is diisobutyl aluminum hydride. My bad. So this is all like kind of one word because it's the name of a compound. So this A will be small. Yeah. So D, di, IB, isobutyl, AL is aluminium, H is hydride. So formula will be, again, it's aluminium hydride with diisobutyl. So you've got AL, H, diisobutyl. So isobutyl is denoted by IBU, taken twice. Okay. So again, because this, again, it is reduction of nitriles and this thing, right? So the intermediate, like the products formed, will be the same, just that the source of hydrogen is different. So in this case, you're getting hydrogen from SNCl to HCl. In this case, you're getting it from ALH, this dipole. So you get RC triple bond N. So if you're using nitrile, and if you're using ester, RC double bond O, OR dash. Again, the mechanism is the same. Use dipole H. First, this gets reduced to an imine. And this on hydrolysis gives you your aldehyde. Similarly, this also, first you use dipole H, and then do hydrolysis, and this gives you RCHO. And of course, this breaks into R dash OH. All right. So, nitriles and esters, the reagent that you use for both of them is dipole H. But the source of hydrogen for nitriles, you can also use SNCl2 and HCl. When you use stannous chloride, this is called Stefan reaction. Right? The route that the reactions take is same in both cases. So the nitrile is first reduced to imines in both the cases. You get imines, and imines on hydrolysis give you your aldehyde. Okay. All right, next, so this is the method of preparation specifically for aromatic aldehydes. So one is, okay, if you want aromatic aldehyde, what is the first reactant that you will use? Benzene, yes, but benzene is just this much, right? So aromatic aldehyde, matlab, the simplest aromatic aldehyde you get is benzaldehyde, which is CHO. So benzene ke saath, if you want this, if one more, this carbon is already there, it's easier to oxidize this carbon rather than introduce a methyl group and then oxidize it. So you start off with toluene. Okay. So toluene can be obviously introduce oxygen atom over here. Matlab, this needs to be oxidized. So again, there's two ways to oxidize it. Two ways, matlab, like just two different oxidizing agents. Both of them are like related. So one is you can use something called chromyl chloride in carbon disulfide solvent. So this first forms a chromium complex. This CrO. And this on hydrolysis gives you benzaldehyde. And another reagent is using chromic oxide. So this is chromyl chloride. You've got chlorine also involved. This is chromic oxide. So CrO3. Chromic oxide in the presence of acid anhydride. I'm just gonna write it in a different page here. All right. So when you use chromyl chloride, this particular reaction is called Etard reaction. The second agent that you can use So chromic oxide in the presence of acid anhydride. So that's CH3CO taken twice joined by an O. This is fairly at room temperature. You get a complex with the acid anhydride. So in fact, it's this acid anhydride that introduces that you get this complex with. This on hydrolysis gives you benzaldehyde. Okay. All right. Two ways of oxidizing toluene. One is using chromyl chloride. So when chloride is involved, that reaction gets a name. It's called Etard reaction. The first, like a chromium complex is formed in this case, which on hydrolysis gives you your benzaldehyde. If you're using chromic oxide, you need to use it in the presence of an acid anhydride. And acid anhydride is the one that forms a complex with the toluene, this is the intermediate that's formed. And this on hydrolysis gives you benzaldehyde. Do you guys know what is the structure of acid anhydrides? Familiar with the structure of acid anhydrides? Yes, no? So acid anhydride is basically two molecules of acid with water removed between them. So you get R C double bond O, either OH hona chahiye. Riya, what you send RCOOR is basically ester, right? Acid anhydride is you have OH and then another acid here. R C double bond O, OH. These are two acids. In may say remove water molecule, you get acid anhydride. So it is C double bond O, O, C double bond O. So this is acid anhydride. So that is why when we write it also, it is CH3CO, this whole thing taken twice. O. This is what it means. So this O is the O in the middle. CH3CO taken twice is, instead of R, you've got CH3 here, CH3C double bond O attached on either side of the oxygen atom. That's why it's called acid anhydride. So acid, say you're removing like one water molecule, kind of. So yeah, so using chromic oxide, in the presence of acid anhydride, you get the reaction intermediate with the acid anhydride, and this is basically a diester, which on hydrolysis gives you benzaldehyde. Okay, not much, just two more, and then let's quickly revise all the named reactions related to aldehydes, or all of these reactions basically, just give a quick summary of. Next, this is called side chain chlorination. Followed by hydrolysis. Again, as the name suggests, you want aromatic aldehyde. So you start off with toluene again. Side chain chlorination. So isme toluene mein, which is the side chain here? So chlorination, so introduce Cl2 in the presence of light to the side chain to the CH3 here. So the intermediate that you get is CHCl2. So this is called benzyl chloride. Followed by hydrolysis. So hydrolysis with water, steam, gives you benzaldehyde. Okay. So side chain chlorination followed by hydrolysis. Fairly straightforward, self-explanatory. First, you're chlorinating the side chain, which is this methyl group, followed by hydrolysis, which is oxidizing it to an aldehyde. And finally, we've got Gaterman-Koch reaction. One thing that I noticed in this chapter is you have like a lot of really long words. So in Gaterman-Koch reaction, you start off with benzene. I think this you guys had studied about last year also. In like properties of benzene may. So carbon monoxide HCl in the presence of, yes, anhydride AlCl3. Or it can be any Lewis acid. Can also take CuCl also. Can be FeCl2 also. Basically, you need anhydride Lewis acid. This will give you benzaldehyde. So the C double bond O gets introduced here. Okay. All right. So just summarizing all of this again. All right. So if you want to make aldehydes specifically, first from acyl chloride. So let's revise. First, if you're making aldehydes from acyl chloride, what reagent are you going to use for this? Cl needs to be converted to hydrogen. So what will you use for this? Come on, guys. You there?
Oh, dibyl H.
Nay. So dibyl H is for nitriles and esters. So acyl chloride ke liye hydrogen in PdBaSO4. Okay. Next. Nitriles. Okay, next is what Stefan reaction. So Stefan reaction happens between what all? What is the reactant or substrate that you take? Nitriles, yes. And how do you convert this? Yes, so the reagent that you take is SnCl2 plus HCl. All right, this, what is the intermediate that you get over here? Is it like a straightforward one-step reaction or? Riya, be careful. So imide matlab, that's like imide is something that exists. So don't get confused. So this will give you an imine. Okay, awesome. What is an alternative that you can use for nitrile? Which can also be used for esters? Very nice. Dibal H. The formula for dibal H? So, dibal H, diisobutyl aluminium hydride. Start with cations always. So, you've got aluminium hydride connected with diisobutyl. So, isobutyl taken twice. Okay. Awesome. Yes. AlH3 area, because aluminium ka valency kya, like 3, right? So two of them are taken with the isobutyl part of it. So the remaining one is taken up by hydrogen. Okay. Next. Nitrile esters ke baad. Okay. This is for aromatic, this thing. So yaha se you get aromatic. All right, Etard reaction, another named reaction. Etard reaction may, again, similar to previous this thing, what is the reagent or the reactant that you start off with and what reagent do you use in this? Jasleen sent the reagent. Yes, very nice. Jasmine, Ria, can you give the formula for that? Yes, you start off with toluene. This is what you want to convert using chromyl chloride, yes. Formula for chromyl chloride is, yes, CrO2Cl2 in the presence of carbon disulfide solvent. Cool. Next, what is another way of oxidizing toluene? So apart from chromyl chloride, what other reagent can you use? Or let me put it this way. All right, CrO3. So if I use chromic oxide, what else do I need to use along with this? Nice. In the presence of acid anhydride or acetic anhydride. Yes. So CH3, CO taken twice. Jasmine, don't forget about this O, huh? Otherwise it's an incomplete compound. So both these parts, CH3, C double bond O taken twice, are connected with an O in between. That's what makes them an anhydride. ठीक है. Awesome. So this is one way of oxidizing toluene. What other way? So if I want to use side chain chlorination, again, if I take toluene, and use Cl2 in the presence of sunlight, what am I going to get? The intermediate? This. And then followed by hydrolysis. Yes, so the intermediate I get is benzyl chloride, which is basically a disubstituted CHCl2. This is benzyl chloride. And finally, another named reaction. Gatterman-Cook reaction. Okay, what's my raw material for Gatterman-Cook reaction? Is it toluene? Am I correct? Is it toluene? Ria and Jasmine have answered. Yeah, it's not toluene, it's benzene. So for Gatterman-Cook reaction, you take benzene and the reagent. So if you're taking benzene, you need an additional carbon for to make benzaldehyde, right? Yes. So that additional carbon you get from carbon monoxide, CO in the presence of HCl with anhydrous AlCl3. So don't get stumped if in case instead of AlCl3, you can also use CuCl or FeCl2, alternates, Lewis acid basically, to protonate this, click convert this into H+, take the Cl- from here. Okay. So these are all the reactions you guys to make exclusively aldehydes. That's all there is to it. So these are the reagents you need to remember. Now, ketones, preparation of ketones. So again, preparation of ketones also, you've got first method with acyl chloride. Now, in this case, instead of just hydrogen, you want to introduce a whole alkyl group here. And what is the best way to introduce alkyl group? So these are acyl chloride, right? So instead of chlorine, if you want to get a ketone, you want an alkyl group instead of chlorine over here. And the best way to introduce alkyl group is start off with Grignard's reagent. So take an RMGX. Now RMGX, instead of making it react directly with the acyl chloride, is a little bit of detour that we're taking. So first treat it with cadmium chloride. So this will give you a dialkyl cadmium complex, right? So you get R2CD plus MgXCl, whatever, like MgCl joins in place of R. Now this dialkyl cadmium, this dialkyl cadmium, when you treat it with acyl chloride, will give you R dash C double bond O R plus CDCl2. You get back your CDCl2. All right. So your main reagent here is use a mixture of like basically Grignard reagent and cadmium fluoride. So this is step one to get your dialkyl cadmium, and dialkyl cadmium is the one that reacts with RCOCl. Okay. Next, again, we've got nitriles. This is again straightforward. So again, if you want to convert nitriles to aldehydes, we needed to add hydrogen there. But instead, in this case, we want to convert nitriles to ketones, which means that we need to add another R group over here along with the oxygen. So use Grignard reagent for this. Do this in ether. RC. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Good. So what happened is when you treated it with hydrogen, when you reduced the nitrile in an earlier case, you had hydrogens added on both sides and you got an imine. Now, because you're treating with a Grignard reagent, again, same thing is happening, but because your reagent changed, you're getting a different product. So triple bond is still getting converted to double bond, just that instead of hydrogens getting added on both sides, you've got the negatively charged R dash thing getting added to carbon and the positively charged getting added to nitrogen. That is the only difference, but otherwise the same thing. Again, as usual, you do hydrolysis, you get R C double bond O R dash. Okay. So aldehydes, ketones, again, when you have the same, like when your reactant is the same, the route that it follows is also the same, just that because you want different things at the end of it, like aldehydes may you want CHO, but ketones may you want another R group attached to it, the reagents that you take in both the cases is changing. Okay. Next. So if you want to introduce a ketone group to benzene or substituted benzene, so you start off with benzene or the substituted benzene. Again, anhydride. This is something, okay, I'm going to write down the reaction and you guys have to tell me what is the name of this reaction, because this is something that you guys have come across. this, we have also done the mechanism for this reaction. And this particular reaction has a name. How many of you recognize it? Nice, Jasmine got it. Friedel-Crafts, okay, which one? Again, there are two types of Friedel-Crafts reaction. Which one is it? Good, now Ananya got it. Okay, now all of you remember it, huh? Very good. So this is nothing but Friedel-Crafts acylation reaction. See, it all connects. It's like we've come a full circle. This is, you'd come across this in the first ever chapter of organic chemistry when you're doing like hydrocarbons. And now we're back in the last ever chapter of organic chemistry. So you're introducing, like we are taking an acyl chloride, you're introducing this acyl, like C double bond, R C double bond O in the presence of a Lewis acid. This is Friedel-Crafts acylation reaction. Cool. So don't forget your basics, guys. Don't forget. Be in touch with this. So ketones is relatively easy. All right. It's 4:25, right? 5 minutes, we'll quickly do a pop quiz. Achha, before we do it, are you guys okay if the class extends by another half hour or 40 minutes or so? Because I want to complete the whole of aldehydes and ketones. Carboxylic acid is going to take another 2 hours, so I'm going to do that in the next class. But I want to finish off the physical properties, chemical properties. Till about 5:30, 5:45-ish, yeah. So like, do you guys, any of you have any prior engagements or something like that? Okay, if you're not answering, I'm assuming that none of you have it, so. Oh, Ananya needs to leave, okay. Acha, a disclaimer, you guys, the next four classes, coming back to this, so summarizing all of the preparation of ketones, right? Again, same thing we've got from acyl chloride. Like if the basic starting point is acyl chloride, use Grignard reagent plus cadmium chloride. If you're using nitrile, then Grignard reagent followed by hydrolysis. And if you're using benzene, you can go with Friedel-Crafts acylation reaction. Okay. All right. Questions, right? Okay. I'll directly do it from the workbook itself. All right. Coming back to this, yeah, reduction with dibalage is going to reduce both your acid as well as ester. Formonitrile on treatment with ethyl magnesium chloride. Aryan, okay, want a glimpse of all the equations, okay. Going back to the whiteboard. Have you guys like taken notes on this? All right, so these are the five reactions, okay. Do you want me to go right from the beginning? So first, like free for all, like if you are not controlling for aldehydes or ketone, common to both, it just depends on what kind of raw material you take. There is oxidation of alcohol, and then there's dehydrogenation. This is the industrial method. Then if you're starting with hydrocarbons, alkenes on ozonolysis give you, like, it just introduces a C double bond O group. So you may get either an aldehyde or a ketone depending on what is attached over here. If one of them is hydrogen, you end up with aldehydes. If both of them are carbon R groups, then you end up with ketones. Then alkynes. So adding water to alkynes gives you enol, which tautomerizes to give you a carbonyl group. So depending on which alkyne you're using, ethyne gives you aldehyde, any other alkyne gives you ketones. Okay, so in this case, you've got three things. One is oxidation. So laboratory mein, you use oxidizing agents. Then industry mein, you use copper or AG tubes to oxidize alcohols. Now, depending on which alcohol you take, primary gives you aldehyde, secondary gives you ketone. Next, hydrocarbon, say if you're taking alkenes, ozonolysis, and then if you're using alkynes, addition of water. So you just have to add water, uske baad ketoenol tautomerism se automatically you get your ketone, aldehyde or ketone, depending on what you're using. Okay, so these are like the three methods that may give you either aldehyde or ketone. Now, specific to aldehydes, if you're using acyl chloride, if you're hydrogenating it, you get aldehydes. And in order to get ketones, acyl chloride ke saath, what do you need to use? Ketones ke liye idhar R dash introduce karna hai na, wo kidhar se aayega? Where do you get, what is a popular reagent to introduce R dash group, alkyl groups? So blue say you get aldehyde, and black may whatever I'm writing, you get ketone. Jasmine answered CDCl2. But is that complete? You want to introduce a whole R dash group, another alkyl group, right? Well, where do you usually get it from? So you need to use a mixture of Grignard reagent and CDCl2. So this is going to give you a dialkyl cadmium, so CdR dash 2, which on reaction with the acyl chloride will give you the ketone. Next, when you use nitrile, if you're using stannous chloride, it's called Stefan reaction. You go through an imine, which on hydrolysis gives you a ketone, aldehyde. Now, in order to get a ketone, what reagent do you use here? Use dibal H or stannous chloride HCl for your reduction to get aldehydes. If you want to introduce alkyl group and create a ketone out of this, then what reagent do you use here? Yes, Grignard reagent. Very good. So Grignard reagent set, mara alkyl group will get introduced. Again, in this case, you get an imine. In that case, you get a kind of a substituted imine. So H being added on both sides. In Grignard's reagent case, you get R dash and NMGX, which on hydrolysis turns to C double bond O. My video is also off. Aryan, you're not alone, because I also keep getting, say, messages that internet connection is not stable, which is why I keep checking with you guys whether you're able to hear me or not. Okay, you guys able to follow? Ritvik, Siddharth, You guys have been quiet for a while.
Yes, ma'am. I've already noted them down.
Okay. ठीक है. In the case of, all right. So in the case of to create aromatic aldehyde, you start off with aromatic compound. It's easy to oxidize a methyl group that's already there. So you take toluene. Oxidizing agents, you've got chromyl chloride, or you've got chromic acid. So chromyl chloride in the presence of carbon disulfide solvent gives you a chromium complex, which on hydrolysis gives you benzaldehyde. And chromic oxide, this forms an intermediate with the anhydride. So the anhydride is the one that introduces the C double bond O group, kind of like that helps in the oxidation, which on hydrolysis gives you benzaldehyde. Then another way to oxidize is side chain chlorination followed by hydrolysis. The intermediate in this case is benzyl chloride. If at all you're starting off with benzene, to introduce a CHO group to create benzaldehyde, you have carbon monoxide HCl in the presence of anhydrous AlCl3. If you want to create a ketone out of benzene, then you can follow Friedel-Crafts reaction. Friedel-Crafts acylation specifically, because alkylation just attaches the alkyl group over there. Acylation is the one that introduces the C double bond O part of the thing. Okay. So these are all the preparation methods. Now, coming to physical properties. So physical properties, again, we'll be discussing the usual physical properties. One is, what is their state? So methanol, bio people would be familiar with methanol. This is something that you might have used, I'm not sure, but you have definitely smelt it. So methanol is nothing but formaldehyde. So at room temperature, formaldehyde is a gas, methanol is a gas, and ethanol is a volatile liquid. Very volatile, like very low boiling points. And the higher ones, like of course, from liquid, they go on to become solids. On the flip side, which is the smallest ketone? Does methanone exist? Yes, no. No, methanone doesn't exist. So which is the smallest ketone? Ethanol. So two carbon atom ke saath ketone exist karega? Like, can I create a ketone out of two carbon atoms?
No, ma'am.
So which is the smallest ketone?
Propanone.
Propanone, yes. So propanone ka common name is acetone. Okay. So this also exists as a volatile liquid. This majority of you, especially the girls, would have come across, you would have used it also. This is nothing but like, this is the major component of your nail polish remover. So you can like imagine like nail polish remover jaise hota hai, it is liquid, but it also vaporizes easily. Like if you leave it outside for a long time, if you leave the bottle open for a long time, it's going to evaporate off. So it is highly volatile. Okay. And yeah, so the higher aldehydes and ketones exist as liquids and then solids. State is directly dependent on the boiling points. So what can you say about the boiling points? As the molecular masses increase, the boiling points increase or decrease?
From the increase.
Increase, yes. Also, this is especially important. How does the boiling point of aldehydes and ketones compare with other functional groups? So, if I have alcohols, ethers, and other hydrocarbons. How does the boiling point of aldehyde and ketone compare with these other functional groups? So which one has the highest boiling point? Alcohol, ether, hydrocarbons, or aldehyde ketones? So, out of all of these functional groups, alcohols have the highest boiling point, followed by aldehydes and ketones, followed by ethers, followed by your regular hydrocarbons. And what is the reason for this order? So alcohols have the highest because they've got hydrogen bonding in them. This we've already discussed when we were discussing alcohols, right? That's why alcohols have it higher than ethers. Then how come aldehydes and ketones have it higher than ethers? Like aldehyde ketone mein, oxygen is doubly bonded to carbon. It doesn't really have an electro, like, you know, hydrogen bonded to electronegative atom. So hydrogen bonding ka koi question nahi hai. Jasleen is asking, between aldehydes and ketones, which is higher? Aldehydes is higher. The reason I will want you guys to answer. Okay, so aldehydes, ketones is lower than alcohols because alcohols have hydrogen bonding, like nothing can beat that. So aldehydes, ketone mein kya hai na? So you, these are basically weak dipoles. So both of them contain the C double bond O group. So oxygen is negatively charged, carbon is positively charged. So this gives rise to a weak dipole within the molecule at this particular point. So within aldehydes, ketones also, I am saying that aldehydes have a higher boiling point and ketones have a lower boiling point. Now, what is the reason for that? It is related to this dipoles only, but I want you guys to think of why and how. Any ideas? So, yeah, so aldehydes, ketones have like the second highest boiling points. I won't say second highest because amines also will have quite high boiling points. So within aldehydes and ketones, aldehydes will have higher boiling points as compared to ketones. So why is that? So the reason for this is aldehydes may reacting difference in electronegativity, but in both cases it's carbon and oxygen, right? Electronegativity is different. I mean, it like the difference would, you'd expect it to be the same because the atoms involved are the same. So what do you mean by difference in electronegativity? Very nice. Riya has gotten it, like she, yeah, that is absolutely correct, Riya. So aldehyde may, the C double bond O, the carbon in the C double bond O is connected to a single R group. And in ketones, this is connected to two R groups. Now, what is the property of alkyl groups? Like when you have a dipole here, like what is the electron displacement effect of alkyl groups? Yeah, so alkyl groups are electron donating, which means that the slight positive charge that's like formed here, the alkyl groups are going to make this difference in the dipole less, what do you call it? It's like less potent. So there is less polarity in a ketone because of presence of two alkyl groups as compared to the dipole that you find in aldehydes. So the charge separation is more in aldehydes, less in ketones. Oh, Jasmine said ketone has higher boiling point. Okay, let me check this because I think textbook maybe it said aldehydes have a higher boiling point, right? Physical properties, you have dipole-dipole interactions. Okay, I'll look into it. I'll come back to you guys in the next class. But generally, yeah, so when it comes to the dipoles, right? So aldehydes are more polar compared to ketones. Like within aldehydes and ketones, aldehydes are said to be more polar as compared to ketones. That definitely does contribute to it. Maybe there are some other factor. I'll check it and I'll come back to you on that, okay? All right, but yeah, so this is the reason for the order of the boiling points. Ethers, yes, again, like the presence of oxygen, it's directly attached to the alkyl groups. So there is dipole over there also, but it is less than what you'd find in aldehydes and ketones. And hydrocarbons, you don't have any oxygens there at all. So they have the lowest boiling points. So this is the trend and properties with respect to the boiling points. Next comes solubility. So organic compounds are not soluble in water, but of course there's exceptions like alcohols and amines, they form hydrogen bonding, which is why they are soluble in water. Similarly, even in aldehydes and ketones, the lowest aldehydes, right? So methanol, ethanol, and acetone are soluble in water. Again, the reason for their solubility is that dipole that they have that is capable of forming hydrogen bonding with water. It is not strong enough to have, you know, to have hydrogen bonding with each other, but because water has that H attached to oxygen, it is, you know, the aldehydes and ketones do hydrogen bonding with water. And as the number of carbon atoms increases, the solubility decreases. Solubility decreases as the number of carbon atoms increases. Okay, and last, coming to odor. So aldehydes and ketones, again, since you're familiar with formaldehyde and acetone, would you say that they are colorless, odorless substances? No, so aldehydes and ketones, they do have a definite odor. So the smaller aldehydes have pungent odor. So it's like sharp and pungent. So imagine, like, biology labs usually have some kind of weird smell to it, right? So even like even back in school, even in like 10th grade, 9th grade, you just enter biology lab, especially something that has specimens kept in jars. So they are associated with a weird, like really sharp, pungent smell. So that is because of formaldehyde, the lowest aldehyde. And as the number of carbon atom increases, they start turning more fragrant. So think of cinnamon, you've got cinnamaldehyde. Vanilla also has an aldehyde that gives you the characteristic smell. So all these, you know, kind of flavors and stuff. So the lower aldehydes have pungent smells, the higher aldehydes have more pleasant smells. So these are the physical properties of aldehydes. All right. Now, coming to the chemical properties. So, chemical properties, you have majorly like five sets of reactions. All of them are pretty easy. So, the first thing is, because of the C double bond O dipole, you've got like aldehydes and ketones are characterized by their nucleophilic addition reactions. Okay, so just like your nucleophilic substitution that we saw in alkyl halides and alcohols, electrophilic addition that we saw in alkenes, again, nucleophilic addition also undergoes a specific mechanism that it follows. Okay, so nucleophilic addition matlab, obviously you have a nucleophile that is attacking the reagent, our substrate reactant. Our reactant is the carbonyl group. Carbon has a slight positive charge, oxygen has a slight negative charge. So oxygen has the tendency to attract these electrons towards itself. So the nucleophile is going to attack carbon. So what happens is, because the nucleophile, like because it's the pi bond that is breaking, the nucleophile has a tendency to attack the carbon atom from either above or below the plane that this compound is in. So it attacks perpendicular to the plane. So if this is the plane that your C double bond O is in, the nucleophile attacks perpendicular to it. Okay. Either here or here, is it? So this results in the formation of an intermediate. Just simple. So again, the three bonds are like is getting converted to four bonds. So this gets a tetrahedral shape. O minus nucleophile, if it has attacked from the bottom. Electrons have moved, so this is why the negative charge is over here. And these two are going to be there as it is. So one is going to be solid and the other is going to be dashed. And this on hydrolysis, like again, not hydrolysis. So nucleophile is basically the proton that is there. This gets added. Watch. Okay. So this is the final addition product. This is the intermediate alkoxide that is formed. Some characteristic that you can note here. So the sp2 carbon that is in the carbonyl group is getting converted to an sp3 carbon. And the addition is across the double bond, across carbon and oxygen. Now coming to the reactivity. So both aldehydes and ketones have this C double bond O structure. Looking at the mechanism, like the fact that there needs to be shift of electrons here and a positive charge that is formed here. So based on this, what can you say about the reactivity of aldehydes and ketones? Which will be more reactive, which is less reactive? Aldehydes or ketones? Jasmine said aldehydes. So is that more reactive or less reactive? More reactive. Yes. Awesome. So aldehydes are more reactive. Yes. Riaz also answered. Good. Nice. Jasmine has given the reason also. Two reasons to it. One is, of course, steric hindrance. And another reason is again related to the charge formation here. So the plus I effect of alkyl groups in ketones. So the plus I effect of the alkyl groups in ketones, it's going to reduce the charge separation over here. Like the nucleophile will not be as attracted to the carbon in ketones as it would be in aldehydes. One, because of steric hindrance, if you have alkyl groups on both sides, that's gonna make it difficult for the nucleophile to attack. Lots of obstacles, blockages. And second is the plus I effect is like the delta positive here is not going to be strong enough to attract this. Okay. Two reasons. Okay. So that's all there is to nucleophilic addition. Pretty easy. the nucleophile gets added to the carbon, double bond turns into single bond, and the proton or whichever other positively charged part you have along with the nucleophile gets added to the oxygen here. Usually it's proton. So complete this set of reactions based on this. So if I have a carbonyl group and if I'm treating them with HCN in the presence of a stronger base, just to make the CN minus a stronger nucleophile, what product will I get? Nice, Justine has answered. Good stuff. So you get products called cyanohydrins. So what is the nucleophile in this reaction?
CN minus.
Yes, awesome. So where will the CN minus get added? To the carbon or to the oxygen?
Carbon.
Very nice. So CN will get added over here. So remaining H plus that is there will get added to the oxygen over here. So this particular product, this particular compound is called a cyanohydrin. So cyano from the cyanide, hydrin from the hydroxy group that is there. This product is called cyanohydrin. Next. Carbonyl group, aldehydes or ketones, treated with sodium bisulfite, NaHSO3. What will be the product I can expect from this? Again, same thing. The nucleophile in this case, which is SO3H, gets added over here. SO2H. And the Na plus will get added to the oxygen. Okay, now this basically rearranges itself, like there is a proton transfer that happens to give you OH and OSO2Na. The other two will remain as it is. So this is important because, okay, 2 points about this reaction. One, it is favored by aldehydes. The reaction equilibrium shifts to the right for aldehydes because of steric hindrance from ketones. And second is this method, like treating with sodium bisulfite, is actually used in purification of aldehydes and ketones. So basically, aldehydes and ketones give the reaction with sodium bisulfite. So you separate them out in the form of this product, this compound that you get. So you can get back your aldehyde or ketone by treating it with a strong mineral acid or an alkali. So this is going to give you back the aldehyde or ketone, which is why if this method, like if you have a mixture of different substances here, the aldehyde or ketone get isolated because they react with sodium bisulfite, and on treating them with mineral acid or alkali, you're going to get your original aldehyde or ketone back. So it's used in the purification of aldehydes and ketones. That's like the significance of this addition, like this particular addition. And you've got addition of Grignard reagent. So I've got C double bond O, Grignard reagent, I've got RMGX. Okay. What, where is R getting added? Where is X getting added? I mean, so where is R getting added? Where is MGX getting added? Yes, so R is getting added to C, and MGX, positively charged, gets added over here. And this on hydrolysis gives you OH. This is actually, we had come across this in the preparation of, so if you use ketones, you can prepare tertiary alcohols by this method. And if you use aldehydes, you can prepare secondary alcohol. So how do you prepare primary alcohols using this method? Let's see if you guys remember it. Like, let's say I want to prepare primary alcohol using this method, using Grignard reagent. Jasleen saying aldehyde, but aldehyde matlab either R hoga, either H hoga, R dash, let's say. So R dash keeps continuing, which makes it a secondary alcohol. Think about it some more. Ria got it. So primary alcohol ke liye, you need this to be CH2OH, right? Which means that on both sides of this carbon, you need only hydrogen to be there, which basically makes this methanol. So if you treat methanol with Grignard reagent, you end up with a primary alcohol. Okay. Yeah, just be a little focused, you guys. Like, just think about it a little, you'll get it. So this part of chemistry, right? So you shouldn't treat it like inorganic or physical chemistry where you need to learn things. Think of this as, you know, some sort of riddle or a puzzle. So you're given like a set of rules saying, oh yeah, nucleophilic addition takes place in this method. Now, you need to apply that to specific situations. Oh, primary alcohol matlab CH2OH hona chahiye, which means that it needs to be H on both sides. So don't like just learn one-to-one sort of thing. Don't like read through it. It's more like problem solving. You're given a set of rules ki agar ye reagent use kiya, so this part of the compound is getting affected. C double bond O is getting affected, or the alpha carbon is getting affected. Now apply that to whatever situation you're given in the question. That's it. Okay. Next nucleophile that is to be added, you've got OH. So addition of alcohols. So again, addition of alcohols, This is special. You get something called acetals and ketals. So if you use aldehydes, you get acetals. And if you do the reaction with ketones, you get ketals. So the first step is pretty straightforward. It is your regular nucleophilic addition. So you have an aldehyde, RC double bond OH. So this in the presence of ROH, or call it R dash OH, HCl gas. So here you use HCl gas because it helps in breaking this OH bond, in protonating this. So the first step, you have R, C. So this becomes a single bond and positively charged R dash gets added over here. The H remains as it is and the nucleophile gets added over here, OH. So this particular intermediate, this is called a hemiacetal. And this particular hemiacetal is going to react with another molecule of the same alcohol to give you a proper acetal. Okay. So first step mein, this nucleophile got added to the carbon and this R dash got added to the oxygen. So that's what happened here. O R dash aa gaya and OH got added to the carbon. Now this in the presence of, like, there's more of this alcohol in the reaction mixture, right? So this hydrogen gets substituted by another molecule of R dash. So it just gives you an acetal. Hemiacetal, because so these are basically gem dialkoxy compounds. So geminal, because substituents are attached to the same carbon. Dialkoxy, you've got alkoxy groups, like ether groups, two of them attached to the same carbon. So in this case, you have only one alkoxy group, which is why it's called hemiacetal. When you have both of them, it's called an acetal. Similarly, in the case of ketones also, so ketone, you have like a different, like a special reaction to it. So you have RR, let's say acetone. So this reacts with ethylene glycol. Presence of HCl gas with dilute HCl. So again, the same thing happens. You get a cyclic compound because, again, the C double bond O breaks and the one of the, like, R group of it, CH2, gets attached to carbon. No, CH2 gets attached to the oxygen. And again, OH minus from the same molecule gets attached to the carbon. So you end up with a cyclic configuration. So these kind of compounds are called ketals. These are acetals and these are ketals. Again, acetals and ketals also can be used in purification of aldehydes and ketones, because on hydrolysis, from mineral acids gives you aldehydes and ketones back. Yeah. All right. So addition of alcohols two aldehydes ketones gives you something called acetals and ketals. So acetals, you take aldehyde treated with, so like two separate molecules of alcohols get added to it in nucleophilic addition. So acetals are basically GEM dialkoxy compounds. So to get ketals, you treat a ketone with ethylene glycol. So ketals are, you get a cyclic structure like this. So in order to get a cyclic structure, you need ethylene glycol. Okay. Next. Final addition is again with ammonia and its derivatives. So ammonia and its derivatives, matlab. So ammonia is NH3. Derivatives are of ammonia are basically if one of the hydrogens was substituted with something else. So two hydrogens are intact and one of them is substituted with another group. So this Z can be an alkyl group. It can be a halogen group. So it's basically like derivatives of ammonia, right? So it's derived from ammonia. So yeah, Z can be alkyl group, aryl group, it can be OH, it can be another NH2 itself that forms NH2 hyphen NH, like bond NH2. It can be aryl group, it can be anything. Okay. So this is denoted by NH2Z. So again, it's a nucleophilic addition. So the main thing, like the main root or mechanism is going to be the same. You've got C double bond O, you've got NH2Z. Okay, now in this, what do you think is the nucleophile? Is it going to be Z or is it going to be NH2? Which one's going to attack carbon? Any guesses between NH2 and Z, which one is going to attack carbon? Like, what should you consider as a nucleophile from this? Yeah, so the nitrogen part of it is going to get attached to carbon. So because it is the same, whether it's in the case of ammonia or derivatives of ammonia, it doesn't matter what the derivative is. So this particular reagent is going to break into H plus and NHZ minus. So if it's ammonia, you get H plus NH2 minus. If it is amine, you get H plus and RNH minus. So the nitrogen is going to get attached to this to get NHZ and OH. Now this is going to lose a water molecule. So this is going to be dehydrated to give you CNZ. This is a type of an amine. Okay. So as the intermediate keeps getting dehydrated, the equilibrium keeps getting pushed towards the right. Otherwise, this is a slow step. So if there is no dehydration, this is going to be in equilibrium. This is going to be very slow formation of the intermediate. But as this keeps getting dehydrated, this keeps the equilibrium is shifted towards the right. Okay. So this is all about nucleophilic addition. Next, the rest of the reactions of aldehydes are going to be fairly small and it's going to get over fairly quickly. So you've got reduction, oxidation, and reactions with the alpha hydrogen, the acidity of aldehydes and ketones. So when it comes to reduction, reduction is basically addition of hydrogen, right? So two reagents, there are multiple reagents actually. One is reduction is, if you want to reduce it to alcohols, all you have to do is add hydrogens on both sides of the double bond. So that can be done using NaBH4 or LiAlH4 sources of hydrogen. Lithium aluminium hydride or sodium borohydride. So if you use aldehydes, you get primary alcohols. And if you use ketones, you get secondary alcohols. This is pretty simple. You have C double bond O. Using either of these reagents, you just get COH. Next, another set of reduction, like stronger reduction reactions, is when you want to reduce them all the way to hydrocarbon state. If you want to remove oxygen itself to produce hydrocarbons. So there are two named reactions in this. One is you have Clemmensen's reduction. So Clemmensen's reduction is when you use zinc amalgam in HCl. So this is pretty straightforward. Zinc amalgam gives hydrogen and your carbonyl group is reduced to CH2 group. And second reduction is Wolff-Kishner reduction. So in this case, you use the reagent that you use is diamine. So what happens here is there is loss of water. You get double bond and NH2. And this, when you treat it with a strong alkali, which is either KOH or NaOH, in the presence of ethylene glycol, So ethylene glycol, because you're heating the mixture, this will ensure that the solution has a high, like you need a high boiling solvent. So the nitrogen is removed and you end up with a hydrocarbon. Okay, so reduction, one is straightforward reduction just to alcohols. In this case, you just add hydrogen atoms to either side of the double bond. So source of hydrogen, you can use either NaAlH4 or NaBH4. Primary, like if you use aldehydes, you get primary alcohols. Ketones, you get secondary alcohols. This is basically reverse of, you know, when you prepared aldehydes and ketones by oxidizing alcohols, just the reverse of it. Then if you want to get hydrocarbons, if you want to reduce them by removing the oxygen atom itself, a really stronger version of reduction reactions, you've got Clemmensen's reduction and Wolff-Kishner reduction. So Clemmensen's pretty easy, use zinc amalgam in HCl, treat it with the carbonyl compound, you get your alkane. And Wolff-Kishner is a two-step process. You use diamine, you get this nitrogen salt, and this on, what do you call this? When you heat this intermediate that you get in the presence of a strong alkali in a high boiling solvent like ethylene glycol, you get your hydrocarbon and nitrogen is released out. So after reduction, you've got oxidation. So again, both aldehydes and ketones, when you oxidize them, the product that you end up with is carboxylic acids. So aldehydes is pretty straightforward. You've got RCHO. When you use oxidizing agents from potassium permanganate, potassium dichromate or nitric acid, your regular, you know, the laboratory oxidizing agents, this gets straightforward oxidized to RCOH. But in the case of ketones, when you have, so ketones ke liye two things. One is you need strong agents, and higher temperatures. So it's more difficult to oxidize ketones. So you need like really strong agents or high temperatures. Two things will happen. One is, actually one thing only, just in different places. So this results in the carbon-carbon bond breakage. So, for example, if you have acetone and if you oxidize it, so this bond breaks or this bond breaks. Either of the bond breaks, because this is a symmetrical ketone, it doesn't matter, like the same products are formed. So you end up with HCOOH and CH3COOH. So if you have longer ketones, then you know all of the different permutations and combinations that you have, the bonds are going to break and you're going to get multiple carboxylic acid product. But you basically, the end product is you get carboxylic acids. In aldehydes, it's pretty straightforward. CHO gets converted to COOH. In ketones, there's a slight change that just beside the C double bond O, the carbon-carbon bond is going to break. And depending on what is there on either side of it, there's a different set of acids that will be produced. So this is like the straightforward oxidizing with oxidizing agents. Then you have named oxidation like reactions. So you've got something called tolerance test. So these are things that aldehydes give, but ketones, like it, ketones usually don't give these this thing, which is why they're basically used for testing between aldehydes and ketones. So tolerance test is also called a silver mirror test. So tolerance reagent is basically ammoniacal silver nitrate solution. So this solution needs to be prepared freshly. You take silver nitrate, you mix it in ammonia in a basic solvent. So what this does is, again, it's not something that you can get off the shelf. You need to prepare this freshly because there's a specific set of ions that you need for this reaction to take place. So you've got RCHO, you take your aldehyde. So from the preparation of the solution, you get ammonical silver complex. So that's Ag. NH3 taken twice plus, so this particular silver complex, and this you are doing it in a basic medium, so of course it's going to be OH minus. What happens is, this is an oxidation reaction, so this is going to get oxidized to a carboxylate salt, and the silver from the silver nitrate solution is going to get reduced to metallic silver. And of course, your byproducts, you get H2O and ammonia back. So it is this silver, once when the reaction happens and you see that the silver is formed, it basically it lines the test tube to look like a silver mirror. So that's why it's called a silver mirror test. You find the silver being formed on the walls of the test tube, you can conclude that it's an aldehyde, and you know, this is a tolerance test. If the reaction does not take place, then you know that, oh yeah, it's not an aldehyde. So tolerance test, ammonical silver nitrate solution, silver mirror test is a test for aldehydes. And then you've got another test, which is Fehling's test. So again, even for Fehling's test, just like tolerance test, you need to prepare Fehling's reagent freshly just before the reaction, in the reaction vessel itself. So Fehling's reagent consists of two solutions. So you've got Fehling A, which is basically aqueous copper sulfate, and Fehling B. This consists of alkaline potassium tartarate, also called, common name is Rochelle salt. So when you mix Fehling's A and Fehling's B, you need to mix them in equal quantities, 1:1 ratio. So you take the aldehyde, add the aldehyde to the solution. So when you mix both of these, you're going to have copper ions in the solution, Cu2 plus ions, in an alkaline solution, OH minus. So this is going to oxidize. So this is going to reduce, oxidize the aldehyde to a carboxylate salt, of course. And the copper itself is going to get reduced to cuprous oxide. That's 3H2O. So this cuprous oxide, so CuO is black in color. Cuprous oxide has a red brown, like rust kind of color. So this is a test for aldehyde, because if there is aldehyde in the solution, it, you're going to get the red brown. This is a red brown precipitate of CuO. So that's how it is a test for aldehyde. So Tollens test, you get a silver mirror. Fehling's test, you get red-brown precipitate of cuprous oxide. Okay, so these are oxidation reactions. Two types of oxidation reaction. One is using your regular laboratory reagents. Aldehydes get oxidized to carboxylic acid. Ketones also get oxidized to carboxylic acid, except there is the bond between carbon-carbon will break just on either side of the C double bond. And other oxidation reactions, again, aldehydes, these are reactions specific to aldehydes. They give Tollens test and Fehling's test. What is happening to the aldehydes is the same. You're going to get carboxylate salts, RCOO. But they're specific because of the reagents that you use. Use ammonical silver nitrate solution, you get a silver mirror. And for in Fehling's test, you mix Fehling A and Fehling B. The cupric ions that you have in the solution from the copper sulfate get reduced to cuprous oxide, which exists as a red-brown precipitate. So if you see the red-brown precipitate in the test tube, then it's an aldehyde. All right. Then we have reactions involving alpha hydrogen. Oh, wow. Apparently, I can't add any more pages to Zoom. This whiteboard has a maximum limit of 20 pages. Huh? Interesting. Okay. So apart from this, we just have aldol condensation. Cross-aldol condensation is same as aldol condensation, except if you use different types of aldehydes like ketones. And then we've got Cannizzaro's reaction. Electrophilic substitution is pretty easy. Like you guys have done this in when you were doing benzene. All right, so we just have aldol condensation and Cannizzaro's reaction. Okay, this I will do it from the chapter notes. Reduction, oxidation, there you go. Aldol condensation. All right, so aldol condensation is a reaction that takes place only if the aldehyde or the ketone has at least one alpha hydrogen. So the reason is that in the reaction mechanism, the alpha hydrogen is affected. Like the alpha hydrogen, like the base actually attacks the alpha hydrogen to produce that to produce the negative ion, which gives you the final product in aldol condensation. Okay. All right. So the main mechanism of the reaction is that you've got a carbonyl group, be it aldehyde or ketone. This is alpha carbon and this is the alpha hydrogen. Right. When you have a strong base around, right, the strong base attacks this particular hydrogen. Now, C double bond O has electron withdrawing tendencies. So it tries to take away electrons from this, which makes this carbon attract this electron, and this hydrogen is susceptible to attacks from stronger bases. Now, this is even possible because whatever end product that you get is basically stabilized by the electron withdrawing nature of the carbonyl group. So this carbonyl oxygen takes away the electron. Now this is facing a lack of electrons, which attracts the negative charge towards this. So this can be in resonance with these two structures. Now, because you have two resonance hybrid structures, like you have delocalized electrons in this particular intermediate, it is possible for the alpha hydrogen to break away from this alpha carbon. So basically, because you're removing, like there is a proton getting removed from this compound, you say alpha hydrogen has like a slightly acidic tendency. And of course, like this always happens in the presence of an alkali. You need a strong base for this mechanism to occur. Okay, so when you have aldehydes and you put them in the presence of a really strong base, like NaOH or KOH, in the presence of alkali, what happens is these aldehyde molecules basically act on each other. So you've got CH3, C double bond O, H. Let me break this up. And then you have C double bond OH. Right? Now, it is the natural tendency of aldehydes. So this oxygen has a slight negative charge, carbon has a slight positive charge. In the presence of a base, some molecules get affected where they lose this particular hydrogen. And you have a negative charge over here. So, these electrons shift here, and the H plus that is lost because of the base gets attached over here. And this negative charge basically attacks the positive charge over here. Jasleen, you have to go at 6, so it's already almost 5:45, right? Okay, should I continue aldol condensation in the next class then? Would that be better? Yeah, I'll do aldol condensation like right from the top from next class, okay? All right. Cool, we'll end the class here. It's also like a really heavy chapter, right? So let's